church remains the same, a reminiscence of the good old days our parents lived in and of Sunday roasts. Church is a change from lonely sitting rooms. For rich or poor, the aches of age come on. Church is a chance once more of making friends, of meeting the eternal here on earth. Steady on just and unjust falls the rain, across the soaking acres of the grass, over wet pavements, and by dripping boughs, we pilgrims plod to the last shrine of all, the best attended and the most revered, the sacred altar of the Sunday press. What's in, what's out, what's on? We ought to know, for if we don't, we won't be thought informed. Willingly, we make offerings at the shrine. On Sundays, too, we ask relations round, or maybe buy them flowers, or maybe not. And Sunday is the day for sleeping in. The newest feature of our Sunday streets, on double time upon the day of rest, the deafening dawn chorus of the drills.
John Betjeman's broadcasting career goes back over 45 years, nor has he worked exclusively for the BBC. His programmes, his books, and of course his poetry, are a celebration of all that he cares about most deeply. Railways, architecture, church, and what he calls things dim, neglected, or forgotten. Above all, it's Betjeman's enthusiasm which I think has so endeared him to viewers, listeners, and readers alike. A mind of extraordinary originality. There's no one else remotely like him, said Maurice Barra, his mentor from Oxford days. Betjeman was knighted in 1969 and has been the Poet Laureate since 1972. A more recent area of activity for Betjeman has been the recording of some of his poems with musical accompaniment.
So completely, you who pressed me closely to you, hard against your party frock.
At a studio in Maybury Gardens off Wilsdon High Road in London, the antics at Wendy's party are committed to disc.
Recovered while the rest played hide and seek, holding hands, our two hearts beating in the bedroom silence round us. Holding hands and hardly hearing sudden footstep, thud and shriek.
Banana Blush was the first such record. The composer is Jim Parker.
Love that lay too deep for kissing. Where is Wendy? Wendy's missing. Love so pure it had to end. Love so strong. Oh, my brain's going.
Don't worry. I'm going to try that again, I think.
I forgot it all.
Yes, yes. It went all right, and then it sort of disintegrated about...
Yes, no. Well, you'll do another take.
Yes, it's yes, right. Yes.
How did all this start? Can you hear me, John, with those
Yes.
on? How did it all start, this, with the music and the poems? Well, it was your idea, Jim.
It wasn't my idea. The idea was put to me, actually, by Hugh Murphy, the original producer, and Charisma Records, that we might approach Sir John and make a record, which we did.
What did you think, John, when it was first suggested, putting your poems to music?
I was delighted and absolutely amazed that anyone should take that trouble with them.
John, do you consider yourself musical?
No, I can't sing in tune. Therefore, I was always told by my parents that I wasn't musical.
But do you like music?
Oh, yes. I can hear it in my inner ear.
Yes.
And I suppose I know when a thing is out of tune. And I certainly, when the rhythm is wrong in anything, I know it.
Jim, you've done, what, how many records now?
Four altogether.
So that's quite a lot of poems.
That's four LPs, yes. It is a lot of poems, yes. I haven't actually counted them, but it's quite a few.
Did you choose which poems to put to music?
On the whole, with various suggestions from producers and sometimes from John.
Yeah.
I think the dear little thing did most of his selecting himself.
With your approval?
Well, I was only too glad to have it done.
Was there a real Wendy, John?
Yes. I think you could say it would be Peggy Purecast.
Yes. A little girl you wrote about in some of my ballads.
Yes. A largish, gold-haired creature. No sex in it at all, just love. And I see myself entirely as a passive creature in it all.
Did you fall in love a lot as a little boy?
Yes. I wonder if she's still alive, and if so, where she lives. And whether she's as beautiful as I thought she was. Purecast was the name of a Dean of York. It must have been a relation.
Have you got a favourite, John? The ones
No.
that Jim's done?
No, I think that each one strikes lucky. And they're always a surprise to me.
Have some people who love your poetry rather disapproved of the fact that they're being set to music?
I think they have, yes.
I wouldn't suggest a poem that I thought wasn't suitable for music, because I think you'd just ruin it totally.
Yes. How do you do it, Jim? I mean, I
Well, I read the poems and see what ideas come, if any. And it sometimes takes... Eventually the ideas seem to come, because I actually like setting these poems particularly, but it sometimes takes time.
Yes.
But eventually something arrives.
Does the rhythm get in the way?
Of the poem?
Yes.
No, it doesn't.
Of the music?
No.
Do you mean the rhythm of the poem get in the way?
Yes.
No, it doesn't. I mean, I don't always try and fit the rhythm of the music to the rhythm of the poem. In fact, on the whole, I don't do that. That's really songwriting.
Yes.
I tended to make them different and not overload the music when the poem is actually going on, but just try to colour it.
You want to do another take anyway, don't you?
Shall we?
Yes.
If I could have a throat pastille, if I may coin a French word, I wonder if there is... Has anyone got
He's got a throat pastille.
There's some water here, John. There's a star.
Isn't as good as... Well... I dare say I'll be all right. There are sort of... zoobs or something like that.
Yes.
That'd be quite good.
We'll go out and get
them. Thank you very much.
At this point in the proceedings, Betjeman began to play a favourite game of his, pretending to be an outsider, criticising John Betjeman.
I don't think he was so good on the day he came to Maybury Gardens. Oh, what made you think that? Well, he didn't seem to concentrate. It might have been a stage fright. I rather doubt that.
John, you don't get nervous at performing, do you, at all?
Not in the lovely glare of these lights. I can't see anyone.
Okay, shall we have another go?
Yes.
Thank you.
In among the silver birches, winding ways of tarmac wander, and the signs to Bussock Bottom, Tussock Wood, and Windy Break, gabled lodges, tile-hung churches, catch the lights of our Lagonda as we drive to Wendy's party, lemon curd and Christmas cake.
Can we cut it there, please? Hold it. We've got a
change. Out among the silver birches, all the bells of all the churches sounded in the Bath West, running out into the frosty air. Wendy speeded my undressing. Wendy is the sheets caressing. Wendy bending gives a blessing, holds me as I drift to dreamland, safe inside my slumber well.
John Betjeman made this sponsored film about the National Trust in 1959.
Driving is no pleasure in this sort of thing. I suppose all the noise and strains and frustration are necessary. After all, I'm in the mechanical age, and so I'd better put up with it. And it has its advantages. Shut up, you neurotic ass. It has its advantages, for it makes the motor cars and the comforts of life. But the noisier the world grows in the cities, the more precious I find the places of tranquility and permanence. This island isn't big and it's very overcrowded. Muddle like this makes me long for birdsong instead of traffic roar, flower smells instead of fumes. In the end, this road will take me to Cornwall, to North Cornwall, where I was brought up as a child, and to a part of it which has been kept in its natural state, not by the government, or by any private landlord, but by the National Trust. Cornwall to be seen at walking pace. Now there's time to breathe and see and smell and hear. Spring is the best time in Cornwall, when the hedges and turf are like acres of wild rock garden, when sea pinks colour the cliffs for miles. There's always a breeze on these heights. It's only in the lanes, in between the high hedges, that you can get out of it. And even then, there is wind enough to blow a gate shut. I remember the consternation there was when this piece of headland, Pentire, came up for sale. But local people subscribed to buy it and gave it to the National Trust, so that it is now an open space forever for all to enjoy.
Despite his illness, John Betjeman still comes regularly to Cornwall, as he has done all his life. His father, with whom Betjeman had such difficulties as a child, had a holiday house near Padstow on the north coast from before the First World War. An old friend of Betjeman's is Cheska Sharp.
Has all that changed very much, John, that view?
No. Hasn't at all.
Except for that big white thing.
Yes, that... what are they, flats?
Yes.
Well, do you see? Building through there, do you see? On the right. Looks a bit like that building at Poulteth that you call Trebenadorm.
Oh, yes, I know the thing, yes. Oh, Lord, yes. No, I can't see that, fortunately.
How early do you remember John, Cheska? You remember him as a boy, young man?
When I was about four, I suppose.
Yes. You would have been
at Oxford, I suppose.
I think so, and very superior.
Well, Alistair took me to see you once, and what I chiefly remember about it was that you stuck those very small sticky labels on my nose. You know, those little adhesive labels with jagged edges.
Oh, yes.
What was he like, Cheska? What else do you remember about John?
Well, gr- grown up and grand, I suppose, at that age. You see,
grand?
From my point of view.
Yes.
They were all rather grand and superior for me. There was nobody my age at all.
No.
So I was usually relegated to Nanny and didn't get to go on the picnics and things.
Oh, Nurse. She was wonderful. Yes. Nurse Macmillan.
She ruled the roost.
Oh, she was very Scottish, yes. Scottish always made me laugh. I always used it as a funny term. A scooch.
Yes.
You used to sign yourself Macbetjeman.
Yes, Ian Macbetjeman. Yes.
And Sean O'Betjeman, too.
Yes, that too, yes.
In the books you gave Aunt Ilse.
Celtic nationalist.
What's that word they've got for tourists? The Cornish word for tourists?
Grockles.
Grockles?
Yes, that's right. Grockles. Yes, Emmets in Devon and Grockles in Cornwall, isn't it?
Grockles is a
word. Or is it the other way around?
Yes.
It's Grockles, isn't it?
Yes.
The visitors have come to Cornwall. Visitors. Foreigners, we're called by the Cornish. I'm a visitor. We litter the cliffs with our houses. We litter the cliffs with our shacks. When I was a boy, all this place was open fields.
John, how old is this church?
Oh, I think in origin, Norman or Celtic,
yes.
And then added to greatly by the Victorians who added that saddleback tower. It's a very ancient foundation, Celtic.
Because you loved the churches even when you were a boy, didn't you?
Oh, yes. I used to think it mattered how old things were.
Yes.
Now I think it matters what they look like and what they feel like. And this feels very ancient.
Were your parents interested in churches, or was that entirely your own initiative to go exploring as a boy?
I think it was my father was very interested in churches,
yes.
But wouldn't say so.
Why?
I thought he didn't think he thought it manly to be interested in churches, you know.
John, what brought your father down to Cornwall in the first place? Why did he come here, do you know?
I think golf.
Yes. But it's a long way to come to play golf.
Well,
it was then. Did you arrive in wagonettes and things when you came
yes,
down those days?
Yes, yes. We arrived by London and South Western to Wade Bridge.
John Betjeman describes his holidays in Cornwall as a child, vividly and with great feeling, in his verse autobiography, Summoned by Bells.
Can it really be that this same carriage came from Waterloo? On Wade Bridge Station, what a breath of sea scented the Camel Valley. Cornish air, soft Cornish rains, and silence after steam, as out of Derry's stable came the brake to drag us up those long familiar hills, past haunted woods and oil-lit farms, and on to far Trebetherick by the sounding sea. Then, safe in bed, I watched the long-legged fly with red transparent body tap the walls and fizzle in the candle flame and drag its poisonous-looking abdomen away to somewhere out of sight and out of mind, while through the open window came the roar of full Atlantic rollers on the beach. Then, before breakfast, down towards the sea, I ran alone, monarch of miles of sand, its shining stretches, satin smooth and veined. I felt beneath bare feet the lugworm casts, and walked where only gulls and oyster catchers had stepped before me to the water's edge. The morning tide flowed in to welcome me. The fan-shaped scallop shells, the backs of crabs, the bits of driftwood worn to reptile shapes, the heaps of bladderwrack the tide had left, which lifted up, sent sandhoppers to leap in hundreds round me, answered, "Welcome back."
You played golf too, didn't you, John?
Yes, reluctantly.
And tennis?
Yes.
Did you play at the race first?
Enthusiastically. On planting.
Were you really good?
Yes.
John, were you good?
Oh, none at all.
Eh?
No.
I remember peering through the hedge to watch this. They used to have little tournaments, didn't they?
Yes.
Little tiny silver cups.
Yes, we did. Yes, by Jove.
Did you ever sail, John?
Yes.
Did you like that?
No.
Why?
I was sick. I dreaded sailing.
Dear Lanes of Cornwall, with a 1-inch map, a bicycle, and well-worn little guide, these were the years I used to ride for miles to far-off churches. I'm free, I'm free. The open air was warm and heavy with the scent of flowering mint, and beetles waved on bending leaves of grass, and all the baking countryside was kind. Don't fidget, boy. Attention when I speak. As I was saying, now I look at you, bone lazy, like my eldest brother Jack, a rotten, low, deceitful little snob. Yes, I'm in trade, and proud of it I am. My boy, it's no good sulking. Listen here. You'll go to Bates and order me the car. You'll caddy for me on the morning round. This afternoon, you'll help me dig for bait. You'll weed the lawn, and when you've finished that, I'll find another job for you to do. I'll keep you at it as I've kept myself. I'll have obedience. Yes, by God, I will. Come back, I seem to hear my mother cry. Come back, come back. He is your father, John. One rector talked of poetry, Cornish saints, and asked me which church service I liked best. I told him Evensong. And I suppose you think religion's mostly singing hymns and feeling warm and comfortable inside. And he was right. Most certainly I did. In quest of mystical experience, I knelt in darkness at St. Enadoc. I visited our local holy well, whereto the native Cornish still resort for cures for whooping cough, and drop bent pins into its peaty water. Not a sign. No mystical experience was vouchsafed. The little ferns just trembled in the wind, and everything looked as it always looked. But somewhere, somewhere underneath the dunes, somewhere among the cairns or in the caves, the Celtic saints would come to me, the ledge of time we walk on, like a thin cliff path high in the mist, would show the precipice.
Later in his autobiography, John Betjeman describes with joy and relief his arrival in 1925 as an undergraduate at Magdalen College, Oxford. Privacy after years of public school, he wrote. Dignity after years of none at all.
Silk dressing gowned to Sunday morning bells, long after breakfast had been cleared in hall, I wandered to my lavender-scented bath. Cooper's Oxford marmalade and toast but half engaged my thoughts, till Sunday calm led me by crumbling walls and echoing lanes, past college chapels with their organ groan, and churches stacked with bicycles outside, to worship at high mass in Pusey House. Some know for all their lives that Christ is God. Some start upon that arduous love affair in clouds of doubt and argument. And some, my closest friends, seem not to want his love. And why this is, I wish to God I knew. As at the Dragon School, so still for me the steps to truth were made by sculptured stone, stained glass and vestments, holy water stoops, incense and crossings of myself. The things that hearty middle stumpers most despise as all the inessentials of the faith.
Religion, and especially the subject of death, occurs again and again in Betjeman's poetry. Among his many ecclesiastical friends is Harry Williams, an Anglican monk at the Community of the Resurrection at Merfield in Yorkshire.
John, in the preface to your church poems, can I just read you the start? You say, churches are preserved so long as people like them, even if they don't like them much. My friend, the Reverend Harry Williams, erstwhile Dean of Trinity College, Cambridge, and a famous theologian, says that churches are banks of affection, and it is affection that keeps them standing.
I think that's true. And in any place where prayer has been continually offered, builds up a sort of, not so much an atmosphere, it is an atmosphere, but it's something more than that, it's something objective. It's an objective presence. The presence of God, it seems to me, is located in places where people have prayed faithfully for a number of years. And I believe this to be true not only in Christian churches, but I felt the same in mosques, actually, particularly, for instance, in the Blue Mosque in Istanbul. But and it's certainly true of churches. Wouldn't you agree?
Absolutely.
John, church, I know, is very important. I mean, you go to church every Sunday, don't you?
Yes, if I can.
And have you always, all your life?
No, I like it. I used to think it was boring when I was at school.
Mm.
But not very boring. It was much nicer than the other boys. And now I can't do without it. I think it fulfills something that needs an outlet.
Yes.
Can I chip in here?
Yes, no,
I think that since I've known you, when I first knew you years and years ago, the sort of churches you preferred and really wanted were definitely Anglo-Catholic
churches. Oh, yes.
Whereas I may be wrong about this, but I think that now you're much more drawn perhaps to what I would call ordinary C of E.
Yes.
That is to say, a sort of church which is averagely Anglican and what you used to call middle stump.
That's right.
And I think you feel at home. Am I right?
Absolutely right.
Bressingham, the diocese, Norwich, which includes most of Norfolk and a little bit of Suffolk. What would you be, you wide East Anglian sky, without church towers to recognize you by? What centuries of faith in flint and stone wait in this watery landscape all alone? To antiquaries, objects of research. To the bored tourist, just another church. The varied Norfolk towers could also be a soothing sight to mariners at sea.
John, you did a radio broadcast about Tennyson about 10 years ago. And in it, you said he held a very vague faith, such as mine.
Yes. Well, I think he did.
Would you still say that about your faith? I mean,
I don't know what my faith is. It's vague. I hope it's all true. And I wouldn't like to think it wasn't.
But the element of doubt is there.
Oh, yes. Always has been. I don't see how you can have a belief without a bit of doubt. I don't know what Harry says.
I'm sure you can't have faith without doubt. But this reminds me of something, and that is that, like some other people, I detect beneath the surface of some of your poetry a view of life not as bloody, but as terrifying.
Oh, yes.
As full of horror.
Yes.
And are you like me? Is your doubt really connected with this sense of life being so terrifying and horrific?
It is. I think that it is. I'm frightened a lot of the time. Who isn't?
Well, I certainly am.
It's interesting because also coming out of John's poetry is a tremendous love of life, isn't it? Tremendous affection for life. But I suppose those two can coexist.
Well, that is the doubt and the faith. I mean, it's expressed in his poetry that when he loves life, that's his faith. And, I'm talking about myself, really, and when he senses the horror and terror of it, that's the doubt. That's off put like that as terrible, but I mean, I think you see what I mean.
Mm. It is exactly what I mean.
Has that always been there, John, too, that element of doubt and fear?
Yes. From earliest childhood.
What do you fear most?
Pain. I think and then sometimes I think, well, anyhow, that'd be better than nothing at all. But I remember hearing somebody say, of course, as a Christian, I'm bound to believe in eternal life, but I prefer the idea of extinction.
that was a very good man said that. And I thought it was really the most awful thing you could say. But now I find it's true.
I don't believe in extinction. I mean, I believe we go on living after death, but I wish that I could believe in extinction, because when I think how cruel human beings are to each other and how they torture each other in various subtle ways as well as terrible ways, I mean, obvious ways, I find it a ghastly thought that after we die physically, we're going to go on torturing and being cruel to each other. And therefore, I wish that when we died, it was the end, but I don't believe it is. I mean, most people seem to think, if they believe in an afterlife, that as soon as we die, we go to a sort of seventh heaven, but I don't believe that. Do you believe that?
No.
I suppose we shall go on being tortured for a bit.
I suppose we will. I don't see how we could go straight out into bliss.
But is that not what purgatory is about, Harry?
Well, I suppose it is, yes. I believe in purgatory, properly understood. I mean, I think that we go on being trained there.
John, do you read the Bible much?
No. No, I don't. I should read it, but I don't read. I read the Psalms. They're so beautiful. And the well-known passages I like. Let us now praise famous men and that kind of thing. But I'm really... I go by ear, and if I like a phrase, I notice it.
I think that one of the things, most important things, there are many of them that I have not so much learnt as caught from you, is that in order to say something real and perhaps profound, you have to be simple.
And oh, good.
I think what I have learnt and caught from you is that complication and what is often called sophistication in statement is invariably bogus. And your poetry shows that all the time. There's no pretension about it. It's just there. It's real.
That's very nice and gratifying. I didn't know it was so. But if it is so, thank heaven.
Because, John, you've always hated the bogus in others, haven't you?
Hated it, yes. I like things very simple and direct and almost childish.
Yes, I think what you dislike in any form is pretension.
Yes.
And whether it's pseudo-writing or pretensions to class or whatever, this is what you don't like, is it?
It can be very funny.
Oh, yes, yes, one can laugh at it.
Yes, lovely when you can laugh at it.
And I think what the other thing which has meant a great deal to me is that you can laugh at religious pretension.
Oh, yes.
Which is a very great deal.
Nothing I like more than the niceties of high and low church.
You can always laugh at that.
Oh, yes. It's the best, I think it's the funniest thing there is, church.
Cathedral Church of the Holy and Undivided Trinity. It draws the whole diocese towards it. And in its cloisters, made for contemplation, mothers and grandmothers, vicars and rectors, from the towns and villages of the Diocese of Norwich, gather together for the annual festival of the Mothers' Union. Boardswell greets Stratton Strawlis. Potter Hyam is on terms with Little Snoring. North Creek sits beside Melton Constable. And for everyone, there's the chance to meet the bishop.
Here we've got Bishop Salmon's porch, about 1320. Now, that was merely the entrance to my dining hall. So as opposed to having your lunch in the cloisters, or as today, sitting out here in the garden, we would have given you an enormous sit-down lunch from there to there. The whole stretch of that was the bishop's dining hall. We weren't married in those days, darling, so that it was before bishops were allowed to have wives. So we weren't married in those days.
Ringing the changes, treble bell to tenor, unites young and old. Captain of the tower and 60 years a ringer, Billy West.
Oh, that's music in the air, that's music in the air. Once I get hold of it, I suppose that's like smoking cigarettes. Once I get hold of it, that's a drug, you can't get rid of it. There's something about it, I don't know what it is, but it'd go anywhere for it. If I went somewhere where there were some bells, I'd go crazy, I know I should. Bells are life to me. I mean, that'd never seem a Sunday to me if we don't hear the bells. That never seems Sunday if you can't hear church bells going.
I hear a deep, sad undertone in bells which calls the Middle Ages back to me. From Prime to Compline, the monastic hours echo in bells along the windy marsh and fade away. They leave me to the ghosts which seem to look from this enormous sky upon the ruins of a grandeur gone, St. Bennet's Abbey by the River Bure, now but an archway and a Georgian mill, a lone memorial of the cloistered life.
Harry became a monk. Would that ever appeal to you, that life?
No.
Be a monk?
Too ascetic. I wouldn't like having to do without anything. I need to be indulged all the time.
Do you think he'd make a good monk?
I think he would, probably, because it's not half so ascetic as outsiders imagine it to be. Well, of course, there are various sorts of monks, but I mean, most of them do themselves not too badly.
Clergyman, John, was that ever at all a possibility for you? Did you ever think of becoming a clergyman?
Only as a means of... I thought of it as a means of making myself felt. Not really out of charity at all. Yeah. Out of love for my fellow beings? No, I don't think so. I think I mostly think of, well, I don't know.
You've got many friends who are clergymen, haven't you?
Oh, yes. I always find them very comforting and very funny. If they weren't funny, I wouldn't like them.
So you don't like people who take themselves too seriously?
Not at all, no.
You see, it's interesting you say that, because I mean, this is obvious enough. It seems to me the people you love most are the people you find funny in the sense that you laugh about them.
Exactly.
And when you laugh about people, it's a sign that you're very fond of them, I think.
I quite
Isn't
agree.
Isn't that true?
Yeah, absolutely.
Do you laugh about Harry?
Oh, yes, all the time.
All the time, yes.
John, do you ever read theology at all?
No, whenever I do, I always find it very funny.
Well, do you think that some... religion is only valid and theology is only balanced when it is fine funny? I think so.
I think so, yes.
And also, if you're describing the mystery of God, because God is so different from us, it's bound to be funny. Somebody once said that the only real joke is the difference between God and man. And theology is bound to be funny, simply because it's man talking about God, and that's very funny. Mm. It's like trying to play Beethoven's Ninth Symphony on a tin whistle, and that would be funny, or could be. And that's why when theologians take themselves very seriously, I believe that they're wrong, because what they say is, vis-a-vis the reality they're trying to expound, very funny indeed.
What do you think, John?
Yes. Can't think. That's always been my trouble. Not able to think for more than about 2 minutes. Concentration gives up.
But you can feel.
Yes.
John, there's a poem of yours I love in here about vicars called Blame the Vicar. Can I read a bit of that?
Oh, dear.
When did you write it? Do you remember?
In some rather... when I was rather... prissy and thinking other people were wrong and I was right, I seem to think.
I'll read a bit of it. When things go wrong, it's rather tame to find we are ourselves to blame. It gets the trouble over quicker to go and blame things on the vicar. The vicar, after all, is paid to keep us bright and undismayed. The vicar is more virtuous, too, than lay folk such as me and you. He never swears, he never drinks, he never should say what he thinks. His collar is the wrong way round, and that is why he's simply bound to be the sort of person who has nothing very much to do but take the blame for what goes wrong and sing in tune at evensong. For what's a vicar really for, except to cheer us up? What's more, he shouldn't ever, ever tell if there is such a place as hell. For if there is, it's certain he will go to it as well as we. The vicar should be all pretense and never, never give offence. To preach on Sunday is his task and lend his mower when we ask and organise our village fetes and sing at Christmas with the waits and in his car to give us lifts and when we quarrel, heal the rifts. Well, it goes on, but it's wonderful, isn't it? Did you get letters from angry vicars? Do you remember?
I don't think I did, no. I think people were rather pleased with the...
There's a lovely drawing by Mr. Piper here of
yes,
vicar's lawnmower.
Ladies and gentlemen, just a moment, please. First of all, I want to thank Mrs. Lestrange and everybody who has helped her to arrange this afternoon's event, and to thank you for coming. I think most people have got a particularly soft spot for South Raynham and its church. I know I have. And it's very nice to see all the friends coming to help us to raise a little bit of money to keep it going for another 1,000 years or two. And now, let battle commence.
God bless the Church of England, the rectory lawn that gave a trodden space for that bazaar that underpinned the nave. We must dip into our pockets, for our hearts are full of dread at the thought of all the damage since the roof was stripped of lead.